Okay, Broder's got Nixon working on a second term. Osno says something on GIs buying heroin in Saigon, but Ryder's got a rocket on the FBI list of potential subversives.
The movie takes place in 1971, and we had to figure out how to make Washington, D.C. look like it looked in 1971, and so we had to enlist Rick Carter, we enlisted Ann Roth, Deb Jensen, who was our art director, Kim Jennings, who was another art director, Rena D'Angelo, who was our set decorator, and just immersed ourselves into the period.
Is anybody else tired of reading the news instead of reporting it? Do we have any leads?
There's a guy Phil and I know in Boston who worked at Defense when McNamara commissioned a study.
All right, call him.
For me, I'm old enough that I was draft age in the late 1960s. So I was very aware of what was going on at the time in terms of at least the information that I was getting about what the war in Vietnam was based upon. So I was aware in 1971 when the Pentagon Papers came out. I actually was very much aware of this era, and so to recreate it now for me is really like a flashback. Steven sent me the script to read and said we have to be shooting this in less than 10 weeks. So came to New York and got a great crew together. And one of the things we had to do right away was find out how to do the interior of the Washington Post newsroom. Finding a location became the imperative. So we actually found a location in the White Plains, New York, and here we are. This is the actual set that we built within the location. Also, when you go outside of here, certain locations from certain angles look a little like Washington, D.C., but not the Washington, D.C. that's the monuments that we all are used to seeing, like, oh, there's the Washington Monument, there's the Capitol. It's much more of what I call the federal brutalist architecture, that kind of FBI bureaucracy-laden architecture that's very, very much about rectangles and squares and straight lines. So we're using that as our Washington, D.C. motif.
Welcome to the Washington Post newsroom. This is what's known as the bullpen of the Washington Post in the era of 1971, an era, as you can look and see, that has no computers. There were no computers anywhere to be seen. So we all worked on typewriters back in those days.
Rick Carter created the actual Washington Post newsroom the way it actually was in 1971. I couldn't believe it. And then a friend of mine who still works for the Washington Post, Richard Cohen, I invited him to the set to come watch the shoot, and he shows up on the set, walks onto the news floor, and he looked around and his eyes filled with tears. And he said, this is the place. This is the place where I worked.
This way is Ben Bradley's office. As you can see from this position behind his desk, he could look out and see his entire world, all the reporters who worked with him to bring out the stories, and this is all based upon actual documented photos of his office.
Here we go, let's step on the
shoot. It was very much of an out-of-body experience when all those extras come in looking like 1970s reporters, and to be reminded of what that newsroom felt like, all the cigarette smoke. So much has changed, even in our old-fashioned profession in the years since.
And you can take a look at all the details that our set decorator Rena D'Angelo is put, as you can see, in a way that you would never see today. Many cigarettes, phones that have only a few extensions. Everything's by hand. It's almost as if people just vanish for a moment, and it's just us in this newsroom.
It's not the newsroom that you would have seen a year later during the Watergate period and All the President's Men, because that was the new newsroom that was built after the Pentagon Papers. Originally, it was a small newsroom, a fraction of the size of what it became over the years.
It's quite a hubbub when you actually see everybody filled in this set, and they're all in period costumes. One of the things that we have in this set that I really like is, because it's a real location that we built within it, we've got a lot more depth than we normally would.
I like the fact that this set accurately shows that this was the pre-modern era. So even though the reporters were starting to be more modern, they were still using typewriters and sending copy up through pneumatic tubes and editing with pen, and the desks were metal. And so I just love the fact that the set shows this transitional time of journalism.
We spend a big chunk of time on that newspaper's office floor. It's really tough because it is by nature a brightly lit, top-lit environment. experiment. So I led it very simply. It was very challenging, but at the same time, it was great to be able to point the camera any direction you wanted to.
I tried them all. I was going around and around and around. I don't know if they had that as eclectic a mix of typewriters, but maybe they did. I don't know if the reporter brought in their own.
This carriage, that's for a writer. When you get into with a width of this size, that's more people, bookkeepers, spreadsheets, things like that, because they'd have longer ledger entries that they make. So what you want is a true writer's desktop.
And the sound is fantastic. You know, newsrooms don't sound that way anymore. When they were doing room tone or were actually like rehearsing or we were trying to get an essence of what it is and everybody was typing, oh, it's a gorgeous white noise in the background.
While we did the research on 1971 in the Washington Post, we found so many things that we could incorporate into our story. You know, the memo pads, Ben Bradley, Kay Graham had them. We went very, very deep.
Everybody that we met that worked at the Post at the time said, I don't remember color. I don't think it was colorful. So we went in the direction of gray and I made it completely monochromatic and just let the people stand out with little pops of color here and there. I walked into an office furniture place and I wound up getting 40 desks from them and then I got another 50 from somebody else. I know where all the desks and filing cabinets in the country are now.
It was great. I'm born in 1965. The movies I grew up watching, right, were set in that time period. Of course, we all know and love All the President's Men, such a seminal and important film. And so to set foot on a set like that and to be in that world, to immerse yourself in that world, just great fun.
That gave you the chills because it's like standing in another time. All of it adds to the momentum of the film. It was very, very exciting.
I can't describe how much easier it makes one's job when everything in front of you felt so authentic that it was like you stepped out of a time machine. That's a real testament to the level of care and detail that's gone into making this extraordinary set.
You could just walk around that room and read all these letters from Ben Bradley to the editors of the Washington Post, newspapers of that time, magazines of that time. It was great fun to wander through that and check it all out.
I hung around there a lot. I took naps on people's couches and they said, oh, you're not in this shot. I said, well, what am I gonna do? I mean, I'm gonna stay here like Ben Bradley did. So I read and I did some writing and I would get together with the other people who weren't working and we would talk or rehearse other scenes. That set was the full magic of the Magic Factory, and that it's as deep as it is and goes as far as it does. It ends up being part of the time machine that movies can be.
This is Katherine Graham's office, the executive suite. This is where she had her office and all of her memorabilia. And we have a lot of this documented from a 60 Minutes episode that they did with Mike Wallace, was in an office like this.
Katherine Graham was more closed off. She was upstairs on the executive floor. She was with the boardroom. She was with all of the lawyers and the business people. And her office is more masculine in keeping with what the Washington Post was. It's not her taste in there. It was very wooden, very straight lines. And then she had her pictures behind her desk and some flowers to bring in a little bit of her. I added some curtains to the windows instead of just having blinds like everywhere else. I think her personality came through, but it was just a tiny little piece of it.
Read just like you're talking to yourself, you're reading the passage.
The director inserts so many of the props that we've created for the movie. They actually are characters. The first character prop would be the Xerox machine. And that Xerox machine was very specific and was a Xerox 914. And we found one at the Xerox Museum up in Rochester, and they were kind enough to lend it to us. But even when that machine was in use, it used to catch on fire. So they told us we were not allowed to plug it in. So we had to rig the light on the machine and also the action for the paper coming out because we couldn't actually plug this machine in. But it was spectacular.
Covert ops, guaranteed debt, rigged elections, it's all in there.
And of course, the Pentagon Papers themselves, the star of the movie. There were 44 volumes of the Pentagon Papers, 7,700 pages. You can look at pictures, but you don't really know what the texture is. You don't know how they felt. And so much has to happen when you see the real thing. So I went down to the National Archives and was actually able to look at all of the Pentagon Papers and handle them and sort of get a feel for the paper and what holds them together. And all of that was historically correct.
Well, at least we got the wedding.
And of course, the newspapers, the most important element of our show. We probably created 30 different newspapers, myself and Eddie Iafreda, fantastic graphic designer. He and I, we tirelessly went and found all the copies of all of the papers that we needed, all the days from the New York Times and all the days from the Washington Post and then some of the other papers. And we were so lucky because I found a barn in the middle of the country that had archived most of the New York Times for the month of June 1971. So I got actual newspapers for a lot of these. And the rest of them we were able to get online. And we recreated them to the sizes and then had them all printed. And also, because they were going to be reading them, several of these newspapers, we did all of the interior pages. Many of these papers play a big part of many of the scenes in the movie.
Sorry to barge in again.
Maybe I should give you a key.
At Steiner Studios in Brooklyn, we have our two stage sets, Kay Graham's house and Ben Bradley's house, the interiors. We've crammed them into two stages, so we're gonna see how they lived.
For Katharine Graham's house, we based it on her actual house that we surveyed, so we built it to scale, pretty much, what we could fit on the stage. And then I had some photos of what her real house looked like in later years, 90-something, and some from 60s. And then I sort of took liberties with color and fabric. I wanted it to be warm, elegant, and have a little bit of her character. I didn't want her to feel inaccessible. I think it's opulent, but I don't think it's over the top.
I feel like they drove out to Georgetown.
Bradley's house, I spoke with his children and his wife after, Tony, Sally, and she gave me a lot of insight. He was friends with the Kennedys. I researched what their houses looked like. He came from money, but he wasn't ostentatious, and I know that they had children in the house, and it was comfortable, and the wife was a bohemian, so I mixed traditional furniture with a little bit of bohemian flair, and I think it came out fantastic.
Again, my friend. You always come through.
Steven was saying how much depth he found in the newsroom and the settings that we have for the movie, and I joked with him, well, I thought it was a verbal Private Ryan.
I think you might want to focus more on what women...
Katharine, keep your finger out of my eye.
Meaning that this is actually an action movie. It's a war movie. But it actually, instead of being a broad canvas in terms of how many exteriors we have, it goes deeper and deeper and deeper in through this personal journey of Kay finding her voice and Ben as well finding his role in all of this and see that it does matter in the world. The linotype process is like looking into the insides of a film camera, where you see all the moving parts. You see how much work goes into every newspaper pre-1980 that was created in this amazingly mechanical way that somehow developed into something that you could rely on to have paper at your doorstep in this era. Fortunately, there is a linotype machine almost next door to where we're filming at Steiner Studios.
I had no idea that the linotype printing machine was as confusing an apparatus as it was. And it was hot lead. Do you realize these lead ingots are literally melted and spit through this thing that throws it onto a plate? It seems so primitive and so archaic. It made me wonder how they even got newspapers made.
The linotype machine, I think, is certainly was a modern miracle. It is a glorious antiquity. And we were able to really bring that back to life.
But the bigger press scenes that you will see with the papers rolling off the presses and all that that you're used to seeing from old movies, that will be happening at the New York Post in the Bronx.
That was certainly a unique experience. It was my first time seeing the printing presses in person. I was astonished by how massive they were. I couldn't believe how many different pieces of machines are used. It's almost like jazz. I mean, the way all these machines work into the next thing to create one paper.
The printing presses were an incredibly physical process of the newsprint and how fast it went. I was intimidated by it. When I was a kid, I just read the newspaper without knowing nearly the amount of work that went into that 3:30 Oakland Tribune that I helped the pal deliver. It's astounding.
Quiet, guys, we're lining up.
The best people in the world were doing our makeup designs and our hair and Nan Roth with the costumes. Together, it's magical. Even myself as Ben, I look different from Ben. I sound different from Ben. I have a different type of body than Ben did. And I assumed that Meryl had the same limitations, but not when you walked onto the set, man. That was Kay Graham, pure and simple, Kay Graham.
Nan Roth is just a genius designer. I've worked with her, I can't even think how many films, all the way back to Karen Silkwood. And of course, she designed Midnight Cowboy and Clute and just amazing, amazing films.
The day that Tom and then Meryl walked into the newsroom, jaws dropped. It was astonishing.
We are ready here. No friends in concert.
Costumes are ready.
Oh, Anne Roth is a riot from my first fitting. You stand there. Don't talk back. I don't think I've ever been clad by somebody who is more into detail and still loves it.
I knew that the most important thing for me walking into a fitting is to stay open to whatever Anne Roth has to teach me, because inevitably somebody with her skill and her incredible preparation is someone who's got something to teach you about the person you're playing. And of course, as soon as I walked in, there's a rack full of clothing, and all of it was completely spot on and appropriate for Meg.
I bet you any actor who's ever worked with her will tell you that, because she has this special quality where she's actually interested, from an acting standpoint, how you're going to use your clothes. I know actors who have found their characters in fittings with Anne Roth.
You've taken this.
Thank you very much.
Based on this, that's what I love about it.
She is a craftsman of the highest degree. She plays with the actor, with wardrobe, with accessories, earrings, necklaces, boots, socks. She just wants the actor to disappear into the character. And when the actor no longer sees themselves, they see their character. That's when she knows she's created something.
And cut, next shot. Great. That's great.
Steven, at this point, he has a lot of trust. Certainly showed him photographs, some sketches along the way, but he came into this environment as it was mostly dressed. What I try to design for him is a back lot where everywhere he looks, he can be in the world that he's in. And he had a total immersive experience that he always likes to have.